ओके
यस 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 ओके देयर इज लॉट ऑफ बैकग्राउंड नॉइस राइट नाउ ओके गुड टू गो Shall we go ahead? Okay. No problem.
ஒரே ஒரு நிமிஷம் வேற லைட் போட்டுக்கிறான்னு பாக்குறேன்
This is good. Perfect.
Is this better?
That's better. Perfect.
Good.
Perfect. Okay. Yeah. You can go on mute. I'll start. Yes. A very good evening, friends. Welcome to the Mahindra Technology Leadership Talks hosted by NPTEL Platform. So give me a moment so that I can share my screen with you. So the focus of the discussion today is basics of electric vehicles for mobility engineers. This is part of the series of talks on Mobility Engineer 2030, a series of tech talks from the Mahindra Technology Leadership Group. This talk series has been hosted by NPTEL, and we have with us Dr. Arun Sampath, who is the Chief Engineer and Head of Innovation and Global Technology Center at Mahindra Electric Mobility Limited, Bangalore. And me, Shankar Venugopal, who is based at the Mahindra Research Valley in Chennai. So we have this series of talks called the Mahindra Leadership Talks, and the theme has been Mobility Engineer 2030. By this, what we are primarily looking at is, what are those future skills that we engineers would need to make an impact in the mobility industry? And 2030 is not very far away. So we are looking at how do we build the skills over the next 10 years and start bringing them into the products. So we have looked at a variety of emerging technologies like electric, autonomous, connected, so on. And this is the ninth talk in the series. And today, the focus is on electric vehicles, the design and architecture. So we have the expert on electric vehicles, Dr. Arun, with us. So I'm going to flash Dr. Arun's profile, and I would request Arun to introduce himself. Over to you, Dr. Arun.
Good evening. Thank you, Dr. Shankar. Good evening, friends. It gives me great pleasure to be part of this particular lecture series hosted by NPTEL. Thank you, Dr. Shankar, for giving me this opportunity. My name is Arun Sampath. I'm currently a Chief Engineer and Head Innovation Center and also the Global EV Tech Center at Mahindra Electric Mobility Limited in Bangalore. I've been here for about 2.5 years. Earlier, I was with Automobili Pininfarina, a subsidiary, a 100% subsidiary of Mahindra in Italy and Germany. Then earlier, I was in Mahindra Research Valley as part of Mahindra and Mahindra. Then earlier, I was with Ashok Leyland Group Companies. And before that, I was in US for about 12 years, my last job being with Daimler Chrysler in Detroit. I have a PhD from University of Maryland College Park, Maryland, USA, and also an MBA University Distinction from Lawrence Tech University, Southfield, Michigan, with a BTech from IIT Madras. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Arun. We are really very fortunate to have you with us here today to speak on electric vehicles, because you are the expert in this space, and it's very nice to for you to free up your time amidst your busy schedule to share your knowledge with us today. Thank you.
Thank you.
I am Shankar. I am a Vice President handling Technology Innovation Knowledge Management at the Mahindra Research Valley. I'm also the Dean for the Mahindra Technical Academy. And prior to joining Mahindra, I've been in technology leadership roles at Cummins, Honeywell, Dow, General Electric, and the Indian Space Research Organization. I studied physics, and I hold a PhD in material science from the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. And I did my executive management education at IIM Bangalore. I'm an inventor with a few patents, and I like to speak on technology innovation topics. Today, the plan of the talk is we are looking at using this 1 hour of time to look at three aspects. One is a quick introduction to electric mobility that I will provide you, followed by two deep expert sessions on electric vehicle architecture and also the future trends in electric vehicles, both of which will be handled by Dr. Arun. So you'll be spending about 15, 20 minutes on each of these topics, and then we'll keep some time at the end for a Q&A. So let's, by now I'm sure most of you are fairly familiar with the rich opportunities offered by electric mobility. So my session is going to be fairly easy. I'm just going to refresh your knowledge in terms of why electric mobility, why it is the future of mobility, and what is the promise and potential that it's got. So if you look at the challenges of mobility today, one is in terms of the vehicle tailpipe emissions, and second is in terms of the traffic pollutions and the risks associated with it. And of course, if you have been in cities like Bangalore, you know that traffic jams in city, urban city traffic is always, every other city is facing this problem these days. So when you look at future mobility technologies, we need to think of how do we make mobility clean, safe, and also convenient. And if we try to come up with future technology options that will address all these three problems, then we are looking at a combination of four very promising technologies, which are connected vehicles, autonomous vehicles, shared vehicles, and electric vehicles. It's a combination of these four which has a great potential to create a sustainable mobility option for the future. So CASE is an acronym that shows this convergence of connected, autonomous, shared, and electric. And the focus of the discussion today would be on the electric vehicle technologies. When you try to visualize how it will be to bring together these four technologies, definitely we also need to recognize what could be the barriers and challenges when you try to bring them together. Of course, when you talk about connected vehicle technology, we need to have seamless connectivity across. So for a country like India, where we are still building this connectivity, this itself could be the very first challenge. How do we ensure that we have this connectivity across? And the second is, when we look at the variety and density of vehicles on the Indian roads, this adds to the complexity of the problem that we are trying to solve. And when you look at shared mobility, now in the current COVID times, we are making sure that we provide all the necessary technologies in a shared vehicle so that it is safe for you to share your ride with some other person. So how do we make sure that we make it absolutely safe for you? These are the challenges around the shared vehicles. And of course, when you look at electric, it's also important to make these electric vehicles affordable so that it becomes an easy decision for all of us to switch over from the current technology to an electric vehicle-based technology. How do we make sure that the electric vehicles are affordable to a large population of people? So these are some of the challenges that we need to keep in mind when we start working on these technologies. But the opportunities are immense. When you look at fuel economy, which is on top of the mind for most of us, you'll definitely realize that electric has great potential in terms of fuel economy. Here we are talking about conversion. When we look at typically 20-25% efficiencies in fossil fuel-based IC engine-powered vehicles, here we are looking at 65-70% and above. And if you look at the electrical energy made available at the motors and their ability to convert to power on the wheels, it's more than 90%. So here we are talking about very high conversion efficiencies. So the fuel economy parameter is a very big attractive feature when you look at electric vehicles. And of course, there is no tailpipe emission from the electric vehicles, so that makes it absolutely clean. The only thing we need to ensure that when we connect these vehicles for charging, the source of the electricity is also from renewable sources. Then we can very confidently say that electric vehicle is 100% green. So that's a great potential that electric vehicles offer. And of course, from a cost perspective, electric vehicles in terms of the fuel cost or maintenance cost, the total cost of operation is very minimal, and that's yet another big attractive feature that makes electric mobility a very, very attractive option for all of us. So today, when you want to make a switchover from your current IC engine vehicle to electric vehicle, typically you may be worried about a few things. One is what we commonly refer to as a range anxiety, in terms of how much distance can you travel with the car. And in this case, what happens is typically you're worried that if you are run out of power halfway through, what do you do? How do you manage to reach your destination? So maximum distance that you can achieve per charge for your car becomes a very important parameter. Second is the initial cost of the electric vehicle. So it's the battery contributes to almost 40-50% of the cost of the electric vehicle, so that it's very important for us to come up with innovations that will bring down the cost of the battery so that the electric vehicle will become affordable for all of us. The third is the time that it takes for charging. Today, we are so used to driving into a petrol bunk, driving out maybe in 5-10 minutes. So we would expect the same kind of charging time for electric vehicles also. So when you look at these three, whether it's the range or the initial cost or the charging time, we find that all these are related to one important subsystem in the electric car, which is the battery. So if you improve the battery, you'll be able to address all these three concerns which are on top of the mind of customers. What exactly is this battery and what are the technologies there is something I will go a little deeper and spend a couple of minutes on. We also need to understand that there are a few bottlenecks which we have to overcome. One is in terms of the charging infrastructure in the country. We need to build the charging infrastructure so that it becomes a hassle-free experience for you to drive long distances in an electric vehicle. Second, we also need to build a supplier's ecosystem for all the critical EV components. The third, in terms of availability of electric power, because suppose all of us use electric cars, all of us get back home at 6 in the evening and connect our cars for charging, definitely it's going to be a load on the electric power system. So we need to make sure that we have adequate electricity power, and then we are also able to manage the load in an appropriate way when we have more and more electric cars getting into the system. So these are certain things which can easily be addressed, but we need to recognize them and start working on them by the time we scale up the electric vehicles. So the key components that I did mention, one was the battery, which stores the energy, and then the other is the electric motor, which powers the vehicle. So here I have just shown pictures of how these two critical subsystems looks like. The battery, unlike the battery in our current IC engine vehicle, which is a small battery which can be taken out and put back, in this case, it's something much, much bigger. I have shown the case of a Tesla Model S electric car, where the battery pack constitutes the entire floor of the vehicle. It's in fact a structural component of the vehicle itself. So we are talking about, if you take the case of a AAA battery, we are looking at about 7,000 such batteries to power a vehicle like the Tesla Model S. Of course, you also see the motor, how it looks like. That's on the right side of my chart. So between the battery and the motor, these are the two most critical components in the electric vehicle. Of course, there are a few other systems, but not as many components that as you would find in an IC engine vehicle. There are very few components that go into the construction of the electric vehicle, and these two are the most critical, the lithium-ion battery and the electric motor. So let me spend a minute each on these two important subsystems, the lithium-ion battery. Lithium-ion battery is the battery of choice because of its very high specific power and also its specific energy. By this, what I mean is not only it can store a very large amount of energy in a small volume, it can also readily give it when you need. So the energy and power both are really very good for the lithium-ion, and that's why it's so popular. Also, we call it as lithium-ion, there are multiple chemistries, multiple batteries that are available to you depending on the variety of applications. But there are a few parameters that we look at to understand which battery is the best for a given application. This would include parameters such as specific energy, specific power, safety, performance, lifespan, and most importantly, the cost. And lithium-ion batteries have been the batteries of choice because they are exceptionally good in terms of their performance, very high energy density, very good thermal stability, high specific power, low self-discharge rate, reasonably low weight, and recyclability. All these are factors which are in favor of the lithium-ion battery. So as I mentioned, there are multiple batteries in the lithium-ion battery system. So here I have just given you a few examples of these batteries like NCA, NMC, LMO, LTO, LFP, and each of this has certain advantageous properties, and each of them find unique applications. NCA is what I have mapped against the Tesla Model S. Then you will, if you have an Apple iPhone, you will see LCO being used there. Then there is a Nissan Leaf, which had used the LMO, and then the NMC for home inverters kind of applications. So there are, this is a very active space. So many new chemistries are coming, and people are also trying to optimize the various components that go into the battery chemistry. So this is a very, very active space for research and newer applications. So there is a lot of opportunities in terms of technology breakthroughs and innovations here to make these batteries more affordable and also customizable for a variety of applications. But the EV battery is in fact commonly referred to as the new oil. That's the power of the battery it has over making mobility very sustainable and also affordable and accessible to all. So this is a very important subsystem that we need to study and understand. The two important materials that goes into this battery are the lithium and the cobalt. Lithium, we have touched upon even earlier in the discussion. Cobalt is yet another material that's important for the electrode formulation, and both these materials are very, very critical. So we need to make sure we understand the chemistry of these materials and also make sure that the supply of these materials is ensured when we scale up the production of electric vehicles. One of the key parameters, like a figure of merit, is the cost of storing a kilowatt hour of electricity in these batteries. If you look at 2010, this cost was around $1,000. And we are maybe at around 170 or so. Dr. Arun would know the precise figure on this. But I've been following the trends. This has steadily been falling through a series of innovations. And in 2018, it was at around 179. And the prediction is by 2025, it will become less than $100. That's the exponential rate at which the battery technology is evolving and becoming more and more affordable, so that you really need not worry about the high initial cost of the electric vehicles, because the battery would become a lot more affordable going forward. This is possible through a series of technology innovations in the battery space. Let's switch gears and look at the electric motor, the second most important component, the electric vehicle. And here, if you have to understand the desirable electric motor characteristics, we are looking at high efficiency, high instant power, fast torque response, high power density, low cost, high acceleration, and should also be a robust system. So here I have shown a few options in terms of various motor configurations that you can possibly look at. And specifically, I would spend a little time on those configurations which are based on a permanent motor. Because if you want a compact motor, you need a strong magnet. And these strong magnets typically are made of rare earth materials. This is where I, just like I drew your attention to lithium and cobalt in the case of the batteries, I want to draw your attention to the rare earth materials in the case of these motors based on permanent magnets. One of the important criteria is the strength of the magnet, what we refer to as the coercive force and the flux density. Amongst all the elements, neodymium rates the highest in coercivity. So it is perfect for applications in high-powered electric vehicles. So neodymium is the core magnetic material that we'll be using in these electric motors. Neodymium, however, has a low operating temperature. So we need to add a second tongue twister called dysprosium in order to raise the operating temperature almost to double of the operating temperature of neodymium. So with this, it can go up to 160 degrees centigrade and becomes very suitable for application in electric motors. So dysprosium, along with yet another tongue twister called praseodymium, can further increase the strength of the magnet. And with this, this material is ready for application in electric motors. So this is the material basis of the lithium-ion battery and also the permanent magnet-based motors that go into electric vehicles. With this, I have covered the basics of electric vehicles and also given you a flavor for those critical materials that go into the construction of the battery and the motor of the electric vehicle. So at this stage, we are going to move to the second topic, which is electric vehicle architecture. Here, Dr. Arun, who has himself built many such electric vehicles, is going to share his experience. And then finally, the third part of the talk, he's also going to tell you what's next, what are the future trends in electric vehicles. So at this stage, I would request Dr. Arun to take over and continue this discussion. Over to you, Dr. Arun. I'll continue to move the charts for you. And
yes, please. Yes, please. Thank you, Dr. Shankar. Okay. Next slide, please. Okay. With the basics on electric mobility that Dr. Shankar talked about, an important aspect of building a passenger car in this particular case, or even a three-wheeler or a two-wheeler, is the architecture. Means the chassis, where you lay out the battery, where you lay out the motor, the controllers, the DC-DC converter, etc. So that forms a very important aspect of a vehicle design. What you are seeing in this particular slide is the evolution of vehicle architecture as we go from internal combustion engine on the left side towards a hybrid electric vehicle that was in vogue about 20, 25 years ago, to the all-electric vehicle, to the fuel cell electric vehicle. So the source for this is the U.S. Department of Energy website that you can see. And what you notice here is the same vehicle, okay, how the different components are going to get packaged. For example, what you see in the top left corner where the IC engine was there, now you have the power electronics controller, the DC-DC converter, the thermal system, means with respect to power electronic cooling circuit, the battery cooling circuit, etc. Whereas towards the rear, in this particular case, on the hybrid electric vehicle, you have what is called, along with the engine, you have the high voltage battery, essentially what is called the traction battery pack. Now, typically in a hybrid electric vehicle, because you have a combination of engine and also battery and the motor system that gives you electric power on a need basis, or depending on the series hybrid or parallel hybrid or strong hybrid, where it is a combination of series and parallel hybrid, you can always have a combination of electric drive or a combustion engine drive combination, depending on the torque that you need, the speed that you're traveling in. And in some cases, in fact, below a certain speed, we can completely switch off the engine so that the vehicle will drive completely in electric mode. So all these things are possible depending on the control configuration that you have, the size of the traction battery you have, the size of the engine you have, the gross vehicle weight of the passenger car, etc. So from there, you are moving towards all electric vehicle. As Dr. Shankar mentioned about 20 minutes ago, the number of components that you see are reducing as you move from hybrid electric vehicle towards all electric vehicle. You will have common components, for example, the traction battery, the electric motor, DC-DC converter, thermal systems, inverter, etc. will be very common. Though their tuning, the size, the characteristics may vary, but these components will be carried over from hybrid electric vehicle to all electric vehicle. Now, as you go from here to the fuel cell electric vehicle, again, your primary source here in this particular case is the hydrogen-based fuel cell stack. What you notice towards the rear is you have a fuel tank, which is the hydrogen fuel tank in the rear. If you look at the top left picture where you have the vehicle with internal combustion engine, there you had, let us say, a diesel or a petrol fuel tank. Now, something very similar here on the right bottom fuel cell electric vehicle, you have a fuel in the form of a hydrogen tank. That is the only difference. Now you have a battery pack, now you have the traction motors, you have the DC-DC converters, etc. So what you notice is now, whereas in the case of an all-electric vehicle, where you see the yellow battery that is covering the entire chassis length, as Dr. Shankar also indicated, for example, in the case of a Tesla Model S, here on the right side, the fuel cell stack is not that big. However, the fundamental difference is the fuel cell stack essentially converts the energy, whereas in this case of let us say a battery pack in an all electric vehicle, it is the storage of energy. That is why you need a larger storage medium in all electric vehicle compared to a fuel cell electric vehicle. Okay, so next slide, please. Now, as you noticed in the previous slide, the same vehicle architecture has been modified as you go from internal combustion engine to hybrid electric vehicle to all electric vehicle to fuel cell. And this has been the case about 20, 25 years ago when large OEMs such as GM, Toyota, Mercedes, BMW, Volkswagen, all these companies, when they were trying to come out with hybrid electric vehicle or electric vehicle, they were trying to use the existing platform, existing architecture, and trying to package the components within whatever is available, because it makes more sense to look at the technology, look at what the customers feel, what is the reception in the market, minimize your costs, minimize your risks, etc. So it has its pros and cons. The pros are your turnaround time, your vehicle development time is faster, your costs, upfront costs are minimized. However, the cons are you are limited by the packaging space that is already available, the sheet metal BAW chassis that is already available. So your motor, your battery, and everything has to be packaged within that particular chassis. So what OEMs realized is now it is better to have a dedicated platform for, let us say, electric vehicle architecture. And this is where a lot of organizations such as Volkswagen, Mercedes, General Motors, etc., started moving towards a dedicated vehicle architecture. The left collage that you see, where the reference is Adrian Chernoff, a reinvented industry, the skateboard platform concept, a 20-year journey. What you notice is almost, you can see about 20 to 22 OEMs coming out with a bunch of different vehicle EV skateboard architectures, where they are trying to fit in the battery pack to the bottom of the vehicle, and then the steering components, electric components, suspension, etc., being packaged. So what you notice in the chassis, for example, you look at the Volkswagen MEB platform, the battery, you have to package it as closely as possible to the bottom of the vehicle so that you will bring the CG down, and that will bring additional benefit for you with respect to packaging space, interior space, maneuverability, drivability, etc. However, you cannot go too low also, because you need to maintain a certain step in height, a certain road clearance. Okay, so again, that is a design that has to be maintained depending on the vehicle that you have. Okay, for example, if you go over a speed breaker at a faster speed, then if your battery is packaged way too low, then obviously the underbody is going to hit against that. So we have certain restrictions with respect to how much height you can do, and that is called the ride height, and also depending on the suspension, etc., and also what is called the ground clearance in vehicle terminology. So you have the ground clearance driving it, the ride height driving it, the step height, step in height riding, driving those design philosophies. Now, what you notice is autonomy skateboard from General Motors, it was pretty much the first EV skateboard in the market. It was showcased in Detroit at the auto show in 2001. And that pretty much caused what is called the disruption and reinvention of the automobile. So till then, nobody ever thought about a flat skateboard, a battery pack, completely flat with four wheels there. So that, and the top hat, whether it is a passenger car or a sports car or a you know, SUV kind of a vehicle, that could be packaged on the top. The top hat could be different, but the bottom could be carried over. So this was a concept showcased almost 20 years ago. And the left top collage that you see now, a lot of OEMs jumping into this bandwagon and then coming out with their own designs. So the Rivian body-on-frame EV platform that you see, vis-a-vis the Volkswagen MEB platform, etc., you have an EV skateboard, not only for monocoque platforms, monocoque bodies, but also for the body-on-frame, means with respect to trucks, whether it is a Tesla truck or this, for example, the Ford F-150 truck. So we have come out with EV skateboard platforms for the body-on-frames and also for the monocoque separately. Now, the rightmost bottom REE skateboard, you notice that this is from a company called REE Automotive. It is a startup from Israel, and they have pushed the boundaries further. What they have done is the entire bottom is the battery pack, and all the controls are within the wheels. They call it as a wheel corner module. So you don't have any wheel control. So it is pretty much drive by wire. So it is a significant extension of the current mechanical and let us say electric system combinations to a purely mechatronics and a drive by wire technology. And this is where the auto industry is heading towards. Next slide, please. Yeah. So what you notice here in this particular case is the GM's autonomy. So this, as I mentioned, about 20 years ago, when they showcased this at the Detroit Auto Show, it was a game changer. And this pretty much laid the foundation for so many other OEMs to take this as the design approach forward. Now, you notice that there is a front and rear crush zone. The B, the E is what is called the universal docking connection, where the all the controls, the wires, etc., the wiring harness from the top hat, in this particular case, the body, come and dock to the bottom. Imagine International Space Station, where there is a module that goes and docks with International Space Station. Okay, something very similar here. You have a chassis on the bottom, and you have a top hat coming on the from the top, and then it docks there, and then you make all the connections. Now then the top and the bottom are able to communicate with each other. Now what you notice is in this particular case, G is what is called the wheel motors, means something similar to what the REE Automotive has done. GM has come out with the motors that are completely embedded within the wheel. So you do not have any motors elsewhere. Okay. So the challenge here is how do we package the motors within the wheel? But the advantage is you don't have any differentials, you don't have any CV joints. It is direct torque transfer to the wheels. So the efficiency is very, very high. That is the advantage. Okay. Next slide, please. Now, extension of what you saw in the previous slide, the autonomy, the GM's autonomy, a lot of organizations have come out with different active wheels or what is called the wheel hub motor concepts. Michelin has come out with an active wheel combination where the wheel is pretty much self-contained, whether it is a motor, whether it is a suspension, whether it is a brake caliper, whether it is an active suspension design. Everything is within the particular wheel. It is completely self-sustained and self-contained. Something similar you see in the Bridgestone also. So the concept here is you have a bunch of different sensors on the vehicle, whether it is a lateral yaw rate sensor or a vehicle speed sensor or a torque sensor or a what do you call an angle sensor, etc. All the sensors are tied into these actuators here on the wheel, and they pretty much control the motion of the vehicle. So this is a purely drive-by-wire. You don't have any further wires here, as I mentioned, except in the docking station that you saw in the previous slide. So Siemens has come out with their own corner module. Then Schaeffler, they have come out with corner modules, etc. Now, this was a concept almost 15, 20 years ago. But now this concept is slowly getting towards production. Okay, next slide, please. Now, a couple of more organizations have taken this to the next step. One is a company called Protean. What they have done is they have come out with a 360 plus wheel corner module, where this wheel, as you see the right picture on the, for example, the Protean, this wheel can pretty much spin 360 degrees. So if you have to have parking in very narrow space, all you have to do is just turn the wheels and then go park and then, you know, turn the wheels back to the actual position. Very simple. So you don't have to do, reversing the car and all the stuff. You can do lateral parking. You can do all that thing. Second advantage is because this is a self-sustained wheel corner module with the ride height control, the suspension control and all that, you can easily park the vehicle closer to the curb. For example, if you are using this technology in a bus, let's say mass rapid transport bus, then easily the bus can go closer to the curb, and then even persons with the disability, they can easily get into the vehicle through a wheelchair. So it is that convenient. And the bus can easily get onto the main road because you have a very versatile wheel corner module that can spin 360 degrees. Okay. So what you notice on the right side is the REE skateboard, as I mentioned. By the way, Mahindra has already entered into an MOU with REE. This was announced about 2 months ago. And then they are trying to come out with an EV skateboard and wheel corner module based vehicle development. It is still a work in progress, but that is already there. So this company has packaged the entire wheel control system in the wheel corner module. And in this particular case, this entire vehicle can be remotely operated like a drone. You really don't need to sit on the vehicle and then drive. So it is a complete XBW, means a drive-by-wire system. Next slide, please. So what you notice here is, as we go from a conventional architecture towards electric vehicles, the trend has been more towards drive-by-wire and development of EV skateboards and wheel corner modules. The idea of wheel corner module is to increase the passenger space, connect with the EV skateboard, means with the battery pack in the bottom, then minimize the number of wires and the wiring harnesses, make full use of mechatronics and especially the drive-by-wire. Then the advantage of this is this has faster migration and multiple developments with the top hats. Okay, so that your turnaround is very fast. Now the challenge is, yes, everything comes at a price. If it is a new technology, by the time the technology gives you the return on investment, you still have to pour in a good amount of money to make sure that the technology is mature, make sure that the technology is mass produced, it is accepted by the customers, etc. So as the EV volumes are still picking up, OEMs find increasingly difficult to recoup the investment that they have done to vehicle pricing and sales. So the competitiveness will erode for the EVs in the short term, but as the scale builds up, total cost of ownership, as Dr. Shankar talked about 20 minutes ago, that would definitely come down. Next slide, please. So we talked about the EV architecture in the previous slides. Now, let us go ahead and understand what are the future trends, whether it is a motor or whether it is a battery or whether it is a charging system. So what are the future trends that are happening in different parts of the world? So this is what these slides talk about. Yeah. So we have electric motors. As I talked about, a lot of organizations, OEMs, are moving towards in-wheel hub motors, where the efficiency is high. It is a direct torque transfer to the wheels with minimal mechanical or electrical losses. There are no more differentials, no more CV joints, no more mechanical couplings. So it is a direct torque transfer to the wheels with a very high efficiency. Okay, now you have previously had traditionally radial flux motors. I will come to that in a minute. But now the axial flux is increasingly taking over. For example, where India produces 24 million vehicles with about 18.5 million vehicles to be two-wheelers, this axial flux motors are going to play a very important role, where this in-wheel hub motor can be easily fitted onto two-wheelers, because India produces about 18.5 million two-wheelers every year. So if you are able to come out with the axial flux motor concept for the two-wheelers, this EVs can easily take off. Okay, that is the advantage that India would offer compared to, let us say, any other country, because we are the largest two-wheeler market in the world. Motors with rare earth magnets and then moving away from the rare earths towards motors without rare earth magnets. As Dr. Shankar talked about 20 minutes ago, we have neodymium, dysprosium, etc., which are rare earths. So you have to dig through the earth, do a lot of mining, and then come out with these rare earths, and to come out with the magnets that would have a combination of rare earths for the specific power density, specific energy density, etc. But because of the environmental impact and the cost of mining, etc., a lot of OEMs are moving towards designs that would eliminate these rare earth magnets. So we will touch upon that in a minute. That technology, as Dr. Shankar talked about, he emphasized on the lithium ion. Now, the challenge is, due to geopolitical reasons and also mining constraints, now our neighboring country controls almost 80 to 85% of the lithium reserves in the world. Now, due to geopolitical reasons, a lot of countries, whether it is US or Japan or Germany or Korea or even India in this case, are trying to move away from the dependence on just one country for the lithium. So we are trying to explore alternate chemistries where metal air batteries could be used. For example, zinc and air, or aluminum and air, etc. I will touch upon that in a minute. So that this will not only reduce the dependence on one particular country for the lithium, but it will also give benefits with respect to cost and also with respect to range with the battery. The next is the charging technologies. You must have multiple charging options. As Dr. Shankar talked about, if you are able to come out with charging technologies and standards where somebody could charge the vehicle quickly and then get back onto the road, whether it's a two-wheeler or a three-wheeler or a four-wheeler, that would definitely be helpful. And recently, a lot of work has been happening on wireless power transfer. I don't know if you know, some of the vehicles, even Hyundai Kona or Hyundai, Venue or Hyundai Creta, etc., even today in India, and in fact, some of the Tata vehicles or even Mahindra in some cases, they offer wireless power transfer for your mobile phone. So you don't have to physically connect your mobile phone to a charger through the USB cable in the car. All you have to do is just place it on that particular pad, and automatically your mobile phone will get charged through wireless power transfer. So a lot of companies are doing this for the mobile phones. Now we want to extend this for the entire vehicle itself. Okay, next slide, please. Yeah, so electric motors, as I mentioned, more and more torque requirements are coming in from multiple OEMs, because a lot of people they want higher power, higher torque. So as Dr. Shankar mentioned, the permanent magnet motors are the new trend. Earlier it was induction motors, you know, brushless DC motors, etc. But increasingly, permanent magnet motors are finding acceptance in the industry. Now, in this case, there are two major differences or what you call varieties in the permanent magnet motors. One is the surface mounted, where you notice that the magnets, for example, north-south, are on the circumference of the rotor. And the other case, it is an interior, where the magnets are actually placed interior and they are close to the stator. And then you may have an external rotor or an internal rotor with an external stator or an internal stator. So you may have multiple combinations. I will talk about that in a minute. This is what you notice here. Now on the right side, because you have magnet rotor with a high density, higher efficiency, everything, you have a choice on minimizing the torque ripples, closely controlling the magnetic flux density, etc. So OEMs and companies have come out with different shaped rotors. Like for example, U-shape, where the magnets could be placed in a specific configuration, or a V-shape, or even a W-shape, or a double V, etc. So when you look at this particular reference that I'm indicating here, you are welcome to read through a bunch of different rotor combinations that are available in the market today. Okay. And the top left, the bottom left picture that you noticed there, I just talked about this in the previous slide, radial flux machine versus axial flux machine. So this is what I was saying. Axial flux is essentially the concept of in-wheel hub motors, where you may have the rotor on the outside and the stator inside. And then this will give you the torque in the axial direction. Whereas previously, it was essentially the radial flux you have a traditional motor mounted towards the front or the rear of the vehicle that is connected with the battery, etc. This is how we started about 15, 20 years ago. But recently, as I talked about, wheel corner modules, the trend has been moving towards the axial flux machines. The challenge here is, as you go towards the axial flux machines, you have to package more and more torque and power in a limited space. So how do you increase the efficiency? How do you increase the packaging? And because you are trying to package more and more in a limited space, the thermal management becomes very, very key. So that is going to be a challenge. So these are some of the aspects that you can read through in the reference that is mentioned there. Next slide, please. Okay. The next combination is, previously organizations used to have the motor separately, the inverter separately, and then we used to have a bunch of wires, cables going back and forth, and also EMI-EMC interferences, and also packaging space and stuff like that. But now, of course, it involves a lot of moving parts, cost, everything. But now organizations having moving towards integrated motor inverter, where the motor and the inverter are packaged together. As you see on the left side, you have one from a Siemens and also another from Dana. So what you notice is, well, these are two different designs, but the concept is very similar, where the motor is on the bottom and the inverter is on the top. Okay. So the advantage here is cost benefit, efficiency, less number of parts, and also faster development. But the biggest challenge again is thermal management. Because if you are combining the PCBs on the top in the inverter with the mechatronics or moving parts on the motor, you will obviously have some cooling challenges, not only for the PCBs on the top, but also for the rotor and the stator in the motor. So you will have thermal challenges. A lot of work is being done. Maybe we will have a separate session on that particular topic, but there is enough work going on out there. Now, the bottom that you notice here is motor and inverter. Again, you will have multiple combinations that you can try. For example, the radial housing mount or a radial stator mount or an axial end plate or an axial stator mount. So you have, in this particular case, you notice that there are four different combinations depending on where you are placing the stator or the rotor. Okay, next slide, please. Yeah. So As Dr. Shankar talked about 20-25 minutes ago, we are trying to move more towards motors without rare earth magnets. Okay, so a lot of work has been going on in the form of what is called a switch reluctance motor or a synchronous reluctance motor. We will not go into the details here, but what we notice here is both of them are interior permanent magnet motors, but trying to minimize the usage of rare earth magnets such as neodymium or dysprosium. Okay, so though the advantage of the rare earths is that they will give you about 40-50% higher range, increased magnetic strength, and also increased torque, etc., they constitute almost 20-30% cost. Means the you increase the cost because of these rare earths, and also because it's a rare earth, means the mining is very critical to produce this metal. As supply and demand, as the demand is higher and the supply is kind of limited, obviously the price goes up. So you notice that over the last 15 years, the cost has increased from, say, about $10 a kg to almost $200 per kg, so 20 times. Similarly, the cost of dysprosium has increased from, say, for $50 per kg to almost $2,000 per kg. So you will have the cost going up. So this is also another factor for OEMs to look for designs of motors without rare earth magnets. Okay. Now, one second, Dr. Shankar, previous slide. Yeah. So you may ask, what is the advantage or the disadvantage of switch reluctance motors or the synchronous motors? Some of the disadvantages of the SRMs that you notice on the top left is because you have the magnets placed in those combinations, you have high ripple and noise and vibration issues coming out from that particular combination. Whereas in the right side design, where the magnets are placed in the rotor, as I talked about the U shape, the V shape, or the W shape, etc., this is what is called the synchronous reluctance motors. It offers significant advantages in the form of robustness, high efficiency, low torque ripple, and also the cost can be controlled as you produce mass scale. However, it continues to have a disadvantage that it may offer a limited constant power speed range. What happens is the motors, because of the torque, etc., you are looking for increasing the speed over which the motor is able to produce a constant power. So it will have a limited option depending on the design that you choose. However, even in this particular case, researchers are trying to improve the CPSR value while keeping the design effective and also the cost control. Next slide, please. Yeah. So this, as I talked about, are a bunch of different combinations of integrated motor inverters. Without going into the details, what you notice is there are lots of advantages where you have very little wires going through, you have a minimum number of parts, you have better torque control, you have easy controllability because you have the inverter and also the motor close by. So you have better integration, better packaging and all that. But as I talked about, two things. One is the MCU, means the inverter, etc., that you have on the top, has a bunch of different PCBs and also the electronic modules, whereas the motor is more of a mechanical structure. Whereas motor can withstand a lot of vibration, the electronics may not be able to do it. So you will have a challenge with respect to vibrations, with respect to durability. And also I talked about the thermal management. So these two have to be accommodated in the design. If you are able to do that, then this design will definitely be a good design. Okay. Yeah. Next slide, please. Yeah. So we talked about alternative to lithium ion, and I touched upon metal air batteries. In this particular case, we are trying to look at the aluminum air. In fact, Mahindra also started looking into this aspect because we noticed that there is a potential for us to reduce the battery cost and also reduce the dependence on the lithium ion. So what you notice here is because the metal air battery does not have any lithium ion, And also, aluminum is relatively less expensive, safe, highly recyclable, and is the third most abundantly available element in the nature. You notice that the cost can be controlled, and the range and the torque, etc., could also be achieved. However, the challenges are, once the electrolyte, the alkaline solution in which the aluminum battery operates, as you deplete that solution, the entire aluminum has to be replaced. So you cannot just charge, recharge like in a regular lithium ion battery. So you have to replace the entire thing and then restart the, go ahead with the battery. So that is the only challenge right now, or the biggest challenge. Whereas the opportunity is, it is rechargeable using ionic liquid based electrolytes. A lot of research is happening there. And also solid state rechargeable aluminum air battery is also coming up. So these are some of the areas that will offer good potential. Yeah. So charging, what you notice is there are a lot of charging standards. In this particular case, SAE and also IEEE, etc., ISO, etc., have come out with not only the standards for the conductive charging system, but also the inductive charging systems, while defining how the plug should be, how the cable should be, how the connection should be, how do we minimize the EMI, EMC interference, etc. So these are all the standards that are evolved or already developed in some cases. Next slide, please. Yeah. So we have primarily two charging types. One is the AC type, the other is the DC type. And when you look at the matrix here, depending on the level, depending on the voltage, depending on the max current, etc., that you're trying to look at, you will have different requirements. However, these days, a lot of organizations or OEMs are moving towards providing level 2 AC charging facility, let's say 200 to 240 volts, up to about, say, 3.3 to 14.4 kilowatt power. And also on the DC side, level 3, again, 200 to 600 volts, up to 240 kilowatt power. So what you notice here is these are the major charging trends that are coming out. And there are primarily two charges, except the Tesla supercharger. If you keep that aside for a minute, essentially there are combined charging system CCS and also charge demo, CHAdeMO. CHAdeMO is primarily being pushed by the Japanese, whereas CCS is being pushed forward by Americans, Europeans, etc. Whereas Tesla has come out with its own supercharger standard and also the charging stations that accommodate the supercharger. Next slide, please. Yeah. So I touched upon the wireless power transfer about 10-15 minutes ago. Even here, there is a lot of work that is happening. So instead of having a physical connection, if you are able to go park your vehicle on a surface that produces power, and then either through inductive power transfer or capacitive power transfer or a permanent magnet coupling power transfer, etc., if you are able to transfer the power from that particular source to the battery without any physical connection, wires, then it would always be beneficial. So, of course, there are some challenges. The fundamental challenge with the wireless power transfer is it is not as efficient as you go through a power as a wire. So that is the biggest challenge. Whereas in a regular charging station, your efficiency could be in the 90s percentage. Here it is less than 70 or maybe less than that, depending on the technology that you use. Even otherwise, it is still in development and not exactly being widely approached, primarily due to the complexity, the cost, and also the acceptability. So it is still a work in progress. Next slide, please. So concluding remarks, electric motors, as I talked about, if we are able to generate further designs on the synchronous motors with expanded CPSR, constant power speed range, and a lower power factor, then that would definitely be a welcome design. And motor plus inverter with radial and axial housing and stator mounting techniques, as I talked about, four different techniques with their advantages and disadvantages. This is being pursued by multiple OEMs However, the challenge is the mechanical vibration and also the thermal management. So if those are addressed, then this would definitely be a good design trend. And on the battery side, aluminum air is rechargeable batteries are being increasingly pursued by many researchers. And in fact, a startup, Phi Energy or Phi Energy in Israel, they have already demoed this in some taxis and some vehicles in Europe. And they are trying to actively push this with multiple OEMs in different parts of the world. So they are in the advanced stage of showcasing this particular technology. And in the charging technology, as I talked about, wireless power transfer is still in a development stage. Though it has achieved about say 60 to 70% of efficiency, we still have challenges in increasing the efficiency and also making the costs controlled. Next slide, please. So with this, I would like to conclude where we touched upon the EV architecture and also the trends on electric vehicles. Thank you for giving me the opportunity.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Arun. Actually, each of these topics is a full semester course, and Dr. Arun has very beautifully condensed all these rich insights in this short period of less than an hour, where comprehensively he could introduce both the electric vehicle architecture and also give you a flavor of all the future trends that's going to happen in the electric vehicles. And you will see all this in the next few years. So with this, we are since we also reached the time, it's more than 7 o'clock now, we'd like to quickly wrap up at this stage. We'll very quickly go through our assessment quiz, and you can get back with your answers to these questions, either to us or to NPTEL. The questions are very simple and straightforward. The very first one is, what are the three critical customer needs that can be addressed through innovations in the EV battery? This comes from the very first part of the module that I covered. Second is, what are the desirable characteristics of an EV battery? The third, what are the desirable characteristics of an EV motor? And finally, what are the critical materials that constitute the EV's battery and motor? All these four questions are straight from the first introductory module that I did. Then if we move to the next one on the vehicle architecture and also the third one on the trends, we have three more questions coming up. What are the flux directions in a typical motor and what are the applications? What is the need for development of metal air batteries? And finally, what are the different charging types and what are their limitations? So Dr. Arun has shared a lot of references in each of his charts. We would encourage you to go through all those references. Many of them are very good review articles. So you'll get to know so much about each of these topics when you go through those references. So we'd encourage each one of you to go through all the content and feel free to reach out to us if you have certain doubts or if you want to bounce any of your new ideas, feel free to reach out to us. Here is where there is a contact that I'm sharing here. And also, we would share many of these emerging technologies and recent trends through some of our blogs, and feel free to reach out to us. In the interest of time, what we are going to do is we are going to take your questions and respond to you through email, but we will wrap up the session at this stage because it's already 7 o'clock. So let me thank Dr. Arun. He is a very busy person, very deeply involved in development of a lot of new electric vehicles. So he's taken time off his busy schedule to share his knowledge with us. Thank you, Dr. Arun. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And
thanks.
Thank you for having me. Thanks a lot. And thanks, NPTEL, for successfully hosting this series of talks. This is the 9th talk in the series, so it has been a great support from NPTEL team. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot. Have a good weekend ahead. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.